Madam Chair, thanks very much. I want to join you in saluting Fred Upton for his service to this committee and to our Congress. I want to thank the administration witnesses being here today to discuss important bills and obviously the mental health needs across our nation. We've already heard this morning that we're facing a continuing mental health and substance use crisis that has been exacerbated by COVID-19. And it's affected millions of people across the country, including children and adolescents. That's why my colleagues and I recently introduced H.R. 7248, the Continuing Systems of Care for Children Act. And I want to thank Representatives Joyce, Underwood, and Jimenez for joining in this bipartisan proposal for reauthorization. It would reauthorize two grant programs through fiscal year 2027, the Comprehensive Community Mental Health Services for Children with Serious Emotional Disturbances Program, as well as the enhancement and expansion of treatment and recovery services for adolescents, transitional aged youth, and their families grant program, known as the Youth and Family Tree Program. Secretary Delphin Rittman, could you explain the importance of these two programs to children with mental health needs and substance use disorders and their families?
Thank you for that question and for your work in this area. You know, so system of care approaches for children are so critical in that they incorporate many of the systems and services that touch children and children's needs. So whether it be healthcare systems, school systems, other community-based systems. And so these programs are so critical in terms of being able to ensure that kids get connected to the services and supports that they need.
The president's fiscal year 2023 budget requests more than $1 million increase for the Youth and Family Tree Program. Could you explain briefly why there's a need for increased resources for this program? In respects, it would be obvious based on the conversation we're having, but if you could talk about it in terms of what extra resources can mean in terms of the impacts that the programs can have.
Yeah. So programs like this, again, in taking a system approach and taking a family-based approach, are critical for being able to meet the broad range of needs that children have. Children often touch multiple systems within, you know, any given week, for example. So whether it be the school system, again, the healthcare system, and being able to identify any other needs within the family system are critical as well.
I mean, the key here, I think, is the holistic approach, the wraparound, essentially wrapping our arms as society around children that are facing the challenges and bringing all of the resources, attention, focus to bear that we and to make a difference, and not just a momentary difference, but sustained positive impact in their lives. Administrator Johnson, let me talk quickly, turn to you. In your testimony, you discussed how important mental health is to children's overall health. And I was also pleased to see that Secretary Becerra announced a joint initiative with HHS and the Department of Education and school-based health services for kids with a focus on mental health assistance. This is something I focused a great deal of attention on in my time in Congress. Could you discuss the importance of school-based health centers in delivering healthcare services, including mental behavioral health services to children, and what HRSA is doing to support those services?
Thank you, Congressman, and thank you for your leadership on this issue. As you note, Secretary Becerra and Secretary Cardona did a recent letter to educators about the importance of working across the health and education system to support children and children's mental health. And at HRSA, in September of last year, we did $5 million awards to 27 health centers for the to support school-based health centers. As you know, what we want to do is meet children where they are, and so we want to make sure that we have primary care services, including mental health services, in those accessible locations. We intend to do this spring another $25 million in grants for school-based health centers to do another 125 awards.
That's terrific. I mean, one can make the argument, I think, pretty easily based on all the stresses coming at young today that every school in America should be equipped with a qualified, licensed healthcare worker, and many should have a full suite of school-based health services. So we'd love to continue to work with you and follow up with you on this topic in the future. With that, let me yield back, Madam Chair. Thank you very much, Madam Chair. I want to thank our panelists here today. And Dr. Chung, let me go straight to you. You noted in your testimony that you and the American Academy of Pediatrics support the legislation my colleagues and I have introduced, H.R. 7248, which extends the authorization for two SAMHSA programs, one supporting early intervention services for children and the other addressing substance use disorder treatment needs for youth. Could you speak specifically of the needs, the sense of community mental health services for children with serious emotional disturbances program seeks to meet medical perspective, and what types of needs are we talking about for children with serious emotional disturbances?
Thank you for that question. We know that with children that they present on a continuum, that mental health illnesses start mostly half before the age of 14. And when they present, they do not always present yet with a diagnosis. And so as they progress along that continuum, perhaps, it's important that with early intervention and promotion and prevention services that we intervene early. We know with children that when we do something early in their lives, that we can have a lifetime of impact for them. And so it's so critical that we do work early. And we thank you for all the work that you're doing in this space. We appreciate it.
Thank you. Shifting briefly to the other program, which would be reauthorized by H.R. 7240 Youth and Family Tree Program. Are there particular needs there of children and adolescents when it comes to treating substance use disorders and offering support not only for the children but for their families as well?
Yes, thank you for that question. And adolescents especially are particularly vulnerable to substance use disorder. And so having programs like that were incredibly important in order to intervene early before they become further along the substance use disorder spectrum and get to the point of crisis. So absolutely, we continue to need more services in our communities.
Appreciate that. I'd like to shift topics a little bit to the question of mental health. Dr. Brendel, you described in your testimony the department's recently released report found insurance companies are falling short of providing parity in mental health and substance use disorder benefits, and the department's report documented numerous parity violations. A recent report by the GAO also found that insurance companies have more restrictive coverage limitations on mental health services than they do for medical services. It's really unacceptable after all the work that's been done and all the focus that's been brought to bear that even today, mental health services are being covered at far lower levels than general medical care, and insurance companies continue to limit consumers' access to mental health services. It's also unacceptable that for too long, frontline workers, including our teachers, police officers, firefighters, and others have lacked access to coverage for the treatment they need for mental health services due to loopholes in current law that allow self-funded state and local plans to opt out of mental health parity. Dr. Brendel, can you briefly discuss why mental health parity is so essential for frontline workers, particularly in light of COVID-19 and what we've seen?
Thank you for your question. As you know, the APA supports both closing loopholes for self-funded local governmental programs as well as full parity enforcement, and thanks this committee for its work to that end. Frontline workers were really affected at every stage of this pandemic, both in terms of responding to public need, being at risk themselves, and then oftentimes being funded by these plans with loopholes that do not allow them to seek mental health care and receive coverage for the conditions that they have as a result of their work. due to these exclusions. There's no health without mental health. We know that individuals, there are high rates of depression and anxiety in this country that exceed levels pre-pandemic. We also know that individuals who have pre-existing health conditions fare worse, both in terms of medical outcomes and mental health outcomes, when there is no parity. Parity is something that we need to affect and affect immediately.
Thank you very much. And I'll just note that the Mental Health Justice and Parity Act of 2022 would ensure that our nation's frontline workers have comprehensive access to mental health services. And we absolutely have to close this longstanding loophole. With that, Madam Chair, I yield back.